About 36 miles inland from the Mendocino coast, just south of Willits, California, lies Ridgewood Ranch. It's a place of stunning natural beauty, a place where woodlands and streams and wildlife are being actively preserved and protected. But everything changed when a past resident of this ranch blasted back into public consciousness. His name was Seabiscuit, and in the late 1930s, he was the most beloved racehorse in America. A best-selling book and blockbuster movie had made him a star again, more than 50 years after his death. And since Ridgewood Ranch was Seabiscuit's home for the second half of his life, Ridgewood found itself with a new preservation mission, one that extended to buildings, memorabilia, and history. I wanted to know more about this historic ranch and its most famous resident, so I sat down in the front yard with Tracy Livingston, president of the Seabiscuit Heritage Foundation. I asked him to start from the beginning.
Well, the ranch goes back to the 1850s. It's been a working ranch. Today, it's still a working ranch. In 2002, when Laura Hildebrand wrote her book about Seabiscuit, then that kind of opened the door for the Seabiscuit phenomena to start. 2004, we started the Seabiscuit Heritage Foundation to help restore some of the historic buildings. We have about 23 of those buildings here on site still. There's just a number of things that we're doing kind of all simultaneously.
Now, Seabiscuit actually lived here, correct?
Yes.
At what part of his career?
He first came here in 1939. He was recuperating from an injury on the track. And then he went back to the track in 1940, ran one more race, and that was the Santa Anita Handicap, the 100 grander. He won that race, and then he came back here near 1940. He retired here. He was here for 7 years, and then in 1947, 14 years old, he would pass away.
That's pretty young. Why did he die so young?
Nobody seems to know. He did have a heart condition, and they did an autopsy on him. There was a problem with his heart, and they also noticed at the same time that he had a pair of oversized lungs.
It made him a great racehorse. He had the enlarged heart, enlarged lungs.
Right.
A lot of people know that was true also of Secretariat,
right.
Famous racehorse, but it didn't work too well for longevity. Now, Seabiscuit, before he came to prominence and started winning, was kind of a gangly, unattractive horse, wasn't he?
Well, you know, there's a...
Or is that part of the myth?
For me, it's part of the myth. He wasn't a very big horse. He was 15-1. Man of War was his grandfather, and so he had tremendous bloodlines. Seabiscuit, to me, was a real pretty horse. He was a bay, and he wasn't really striking, but he was a well-put-together horse.
The book and the movie rocketed him to fame in modern times. How accurate were those, in your opinion?
I think the book was very accurate. She captured the time, no doubt. In the movies, you know, they take a little leeway, you know, here and there. In the movie, it depicted that Charles Howard only had one son, and that was Frankie. He was killed on the ranch, and he actually had four sons. Oh. So there was a few liberties that they took in the movie.
You know, the story of Seabiscuit takes a rather abrupt change when Charles Howard becomes the owner of the horse. What did he do differently that resulted in the success that Seabiscuit had?
Well, Tom Smith was Charles Howard's trainer. He just connected with him. He had a special quality. And actually, they started winning with Seabiscuit almost immediately. It was just a few weeks after that Charles Howard bought Seabiscuit, and they started winning on the track. And it might have been because of Tom Smith, some of his unconventional methods of training, a little bit of gadgetry. And there was just a connection. And there was also a connection with Red Pollard with Seabiscuit. And that was depicted in the movie, and that was said to be very true.
Now, Red Pollard was he the primary jockey? Because I know there was Red and also George Wolfe that both rode him in very important races.
Right. Red Pollard would be the primary jockey. And then, of course, the War Admiral, the big match race, Georgie Wolfe rode him. Georgie Wolfe is probably one of the greatest all-time jockeys, period. And then Red Pollard was just a so-so jockey. I mean, after Seabiscuit retired in 1940, you know, Red Pollard really didn't get any great rides from then on. But he loved racing so much that he stayed in it until he passed away. He was a valet or a valet, and for a quarter of the tracks and take care of equipment for different jockeys. So Yeah, there was a real connection with you know, all three of them, Tom Smith, you know, Red Pollard, and Charles Howard.
Now, you said that it really started happening once Tom Smith got involved with the training of this horse. Do you think it was unusual for that time for a trainer and a racehorse to have that kind of connection?
Well, based on the book and the movie, you know, that this was an old savvy kind of guy. It was
he trained cow ponies,
and you know, he just knew horses, you know, and so he seen something in Seabiscuit that other people couldn't see, you know, and Seabiscuit, you know, he had the great bloodlines behind him. So
was there something intangible, though? I mean, some kind of heart? I don't mean in a, you know, a literal sense heart, but some kind of spirit that he was able to tap into, that horse could just give his all when it was required?
Well, I think it wasn't long after that Tom Smith started training him that he seen that he had that within
something.
Him, you know. So yeah. So he dialed into that. He right. pushed that.
So this happened in, what, the mid-1930s?
Yeah, Seabiscuit was born in 1933, and then in 1936 is when Charles Howard bought him. And then Charles Howard continued to race him until he was a seven-year-old, you know, which is kind of unheard of today. And that's when he ran his last race, was in 1940.
Yeah. Most racehorses are retired long before that.
Long before.
These days.
Yeah.
You know, historically, that time, America was in the throes of the Great Depression. And this racehorse and the success story and the human element, the human drama involved in it, captivated the country's hearts and imaginations. Why do you think that was? What was there about America at that time that allowed this to just become a phenomenon?
America was looking for a hero. They found that hero through Seabiscuit. Seabiscuit was made to be a West Coast horse. You know, he was born and bred in Kentucky, and so Charles Howard really took advantage of whatever he could to make a good sale. So he started promoting Seabiscuit as this West Coast horse, and everybody, I think, loved Seabiscuit, but I mean, there became a real rivalry between the East Coast and the West Coast.
Was War Admiral an East Coast horse?
Yes, definitely.
Was Seabiscuit perceived as an underdog?
He was, but if you look at the stats and of the races that War Admiral and Seabiscuit, that they both raced in, that there was a lot of people predicted that Seabiscuit was going to win that race.
So it wasn't quite as unexpected as in the movie?
For a lot of people, it wasn't. You know, that Charles Howard just kind of baited the owner, a War Admiral, into that race. And the owner really didn't have anything to gain, and he had everything to lose. He was racing against a Triple Crown winner, you know, War Admiral was at the time.
What about the life of Seabiscuit after racing? He was a stallion. Was he put out to stud? Is that what he went on to do?
1939, when he first came here, and he was recuperating from his injury. When he got well enough, they bred him to seven mares. And then he went back out on the track, raced his final race. And he came back here, and then there were seven little biscuits on the ground. And so he,
is that what you call them?
Yes.
Little biscuits.
Yeah. So he sired 106 foals all total.
How did they do in racing?
It was kind of a mix. They didn't do really well. There was kind of a theory that I have that maybe the reason why they didn't do really well. In 1941, you know, we had the start of World War II. What happens was that Santa Anita Racetrack in 1933, that Charles Howard helped build, in 1942 it becomes the Santa Anita internment camp for the Japanese. And so you have Tan Foran and a lot of other racetracks that become internment camps for the Japanese. So here was a time between 1942 and 45 where, you know, Seabiscuit, his protege, should be winning a lot of races, running a lot of races, and he doesn't have that opportunity. Yeah. And then in 1947, when Seabiscuit, he passes away, racing starts to get back up on its feet, and then he just really doesn't have a chance to take and produce any more horses after that 1947.
Yeah. Timing was kind of bad, I
suppose. Yeah, when they talk about timing is everything, that's true.
Well, Tracy, I'd like to hear a little bit more about what's happening at Ridgewood today, what your future plans are. Will you show us around?
I sure will.
All righty, we appreciate that.
All right, great.
Charles Howard made his millions in the automobile industry. but his real love was Ridgewood Ranch, a Northern California working farm and ranch that he purchased in 1919. Ridgewood is best known today as the retirement home of Howard's spectacular racehorse, Seabiscuit. Tracy Livingston, president of the Seabiscuit Heritage Foundation, showed me the Howard family home and gave me a walking tour of restoration efforts at the ranch.
We're at Seabiscuit Stud Barn. This was built in 1940 for Seabiscuit. That's the original weather vane that's been always on this barn. Charles Howard had about 20 stallions at different times. Kayak 2 won the Santa Anita Handicap in 1939, took second to Seabiscuit in 1940. And so he was a great horse. Then this was a groom's room. This is where Sarge stayed. He took care of the stallions here. This was Seabiscuit's stall right here. He would look out, and then he would take and go out his paddock and get his exercise. He would die right outside of his paddock door.
Now, could he kind of come and go out of
his
door?
Yeah, he would come and go, and his bantam hen and a rooster would hop up on his back. Huh. And then Seabiscuit would just walk around the paddock
and
with his chickens on his back. He'd like that. He'd come into a stall, turn around, go back out, and when he got tired of them, he just gave them a shake and off they'd come.
Wow.
And then on the left-hand corner of that stall, there was a barn cat. And she had several litters of kittens in that one corner. And Seabiscuit would come up and sniff them and never bother them.
Huh.
You know, so as long as things were done on his terms, you know, he was good with things.
Wow. Charles Howard had other stallions, obviously, besides Seabiscuit in here. Nor, there's a story about him.
Yeah, Nor was a great horse. He beat Citation on three different occasions. And so I put these signs up. And about a year after I put the signs up, this lady, Jenny, came on to one of my tours. There's about 25 people on the tour. And she looked at the sign and she saw, "Tracy, that's a really a nice sign." And I says, "Well, thank you." She says, "But you got his name spelled wrong." And that's N-O-I-R is what I had before. And so I said, "Okay." So everybody got a good laugh. And so I went ahead and had a new sign made. About a year later, she came on another tour. So what a nice sign, she says, "But Nora was never up here."
So, she couldn't have told you that the first time.
So not all of Charles Howard's stallions ever came to Ridgewood Ranch.
Oh, I love this.
Yeah, it's a 1948 Diamond T, and Seabiscuit would have never been in this particular truck, but the cow ponies would have been. They would put the saddles in here up above. When they were traveling, they would hook up the horses with the chains. They'd throw hay in here, too, so they keep the horses occupied, just like they do today.
They would just straddle the wheel well?
They would just deal with it. We used this to advertise the homecoming of Seabiscuit to the town of Willits.
Many of the buildings at Ridgewood are more than 100 years old, including the carriage house, which is in the early stages of restoration.
This is one of the first things that people would see back in the day, and so they made them a little fancier than most buildings. They brought the carriages in sometimes that what they would do, the wheels would actually hit these bars and kind of help center the carriages. And we put a new roof on it about 2 years ago. Now it's kind of in a state of preservation to where we can go on to another building that has more urgent needs.
Like the bathhouse, for instance, a place where the rich and famous once played.
That's going to be our next project. Bing Crosby, Clark Gable, Dorothy L'Amour, a lot of the Hollywood luminaries would come here and party. And this is also where Shirley Temple learned how to swim. If we don't take and do something this year, we may lose the buildings by next year. There was two barns that Charles Howard had. This is the North Mare Barn.
This is the old original logo.
Yes, there are 22 stalls in this barn. And so when we do the restoration, you know, those won't be touched. These are fulling size stalls. They're like 18 by 18. We think Seabiscuit may have been in this stall. when he first came here in 39, because he had Chula came up here with him. Chula was his buddy, and they would want to have Chula next to him. And if you look to the left on this stall here, you'll see a wooden partition inside. And so they would drop that partition down and they could see his buddy. But he wouldn't have been here very long because he have a barn full of mares and you've got a stallion. It really doesn't work out too well.
Yeah. Well, now here you've got another one of those curved corners like we saw in the stud barn. That took a lot of work to build and to restore. Is there a reason for that?
Yeah, I think so. I think there's maybe a couple reasons. One, cosmetically, it looks great. And the other reason is, even today, we have an average of 50 to 55 inches of rain. And so they would actually work the horses or walk the horses around in the dirt area underneath the roof, you know. And so they would be walking around this area here, and they could be coming from both ways. It'd give them a chance to take and see what's coming from the other direction.
Oh.
Yeah.
So it wasn't as much of a blind corner.
That's right. There's a couple other things. You notice this stall door is not a Dutch door, it's just a solid door. Up above, they would dump grain into these hoppers here, and the hoppers would come down into this wooden bin, and then they would scoop up the grain, bring it out, and they would go to these little doors here, which would open up. There'd be a triangular feed pan here. They'd dump the grain in and close it. Then up above on each stall, there was trap doors. And so they'd pull those doors up, they'd dump the hay in. So they never really had to get in with the horses too much. So when we go in here, tell me what you notice when we go inside the stall.
Well, it's cooler.
That's right. It was designed that way. It's got a very high ceiling. And also you have the hallway that goes down the center. You have the breezeways on either end, so it's definitely cooler.
Now, Tracy, I know there are some Seabiscuit horses around. We saw a cute little paint filly that had Seabiscuit blood. So does this one. Tell me about this horse.
Well, this is Bronze C, thoroughbred, born on Seabiscuit's birthday last year, May 23rd. The owner is Jacqueline Cooper from American Legends Horse Farm in Redwood Valley. And then she came over here and shortly after her birth and has been here ever since.
So how much does this horse look like Seabiscuit?
The coloration is very close, bay, and not a lot of striking things about her. Just kind of a little plain Jane, very well put together. Nice little filly, good temperament.
Well, Tracy, thanks for sharing a little bit of the history of Ridgewood Ranch and Seabiscuit with us, as well as kind of a look into the future. Best of luck to you, and thanks for being on our show.
Thanks for coming.
For more information on Seabiscuit and the conservancy projects at Ridgewood Ranch, visit seabiscuitheritage.org.